speakers of the day, Advocate Niranjan Mudragi and Advocate Yogesh Israni. My colleagues, Vice President Raman, Joint Secretary Narayan, seniors, fellow members, ladies and gentlemen. A very good evening and very warm welcome to you all. This is a very different, not so routine topic, something which in a way does not impact us on a day-to-day basis. But if you look at it as chartered accountant, we are acting either as auditor or as business advisor to the businesses. And therefore, you know, in some or the other way, we have to encounter situations where an economic crime is involved. Friends, with economic and technological development, along with the globalization, increasing globalization, is also resulting in increase or rising economic offenses. I was looking at the annual report of 2013 of the Central Bureau of Investigation, and that report lists 24 offenses as economic crimes. It starts with the first crime listed as economic crime in this list is tax evasion. The last crime listed is company frauds. All of that impacts us. And of course, it has, you know, the other economic crimes listed therein are money laundering, foreign contribution manipulation, corruption and bribery, illegal foreign trade, credit card frauds, and theft of intellectual property, stock market manipulations, and so on. So there are quite a number of areas where I think we need to have at least the basic understanding so that we are prepared to face the situation in a better way. The American agency FBI's slogan says, If you look at FBI's website or FBI's offices, it says the crime never crime does not pay or crime never pays. I don't know. In fact, there is a counter school which says that in America, crime is the biggest industry. But I do know that as far as the victim of economic crime is concerned, they certainly end up paying much more. They end up suffering much more. So we need to understand that, you know, in a situation where we end up as victim of an economic crime, how do we face that? So we face several questions, you know, while we understand the entire tax jurisprudence very well as to, you know, right from scrutiny to commissioner appeals to tribunal to High Court and Supreme Court and you know, of course, advance ruling authority in between. Do we understand how the criminal procedure works? What are the stages? How does the NC and FIR work? What is cognizable and non-cognizable offense? What are the different types of criminal courts? And what is the difference between them? There have been also certain developments when it comes to the bounce checks and the Negotiable Instrument Act, provisions of Negotiable Instrument Act. And recently there has been certain very disturbing decisions that have made life much more difficult, and we would look forward to both these learned faculties to enlighten on this. Today's speaker, Niranjan Mudragi and Advocate Yogesh Israni, practice in Mumbai mostly on criminal law, and especially, you know, all white collar crimes like economic offenses, check bouncing, prevention of money laundering, prevention of corruption. And they have extensive experience in litigation, courts, magistrate and session courts and high court. And they've been handling quite a few or several high profile cases. And therefore, you know, we look forward to them sharing their experience with us. So before I invite, I think in terms of the allocation of topics, Niranjan would take us through the entire criminal law procedure and the economic offense swing related processes. And Yogesh would take us through the negotiable instruments and bounce check related provisions. So before I invite them to address us, I request Vice President Raman to felicitate them with a memento as token of our appreciation. I invite Niranjan to come and address us.
Advocate Niranjan Mundarge, I'm practicing for last 15 years on criminal side at Bombay High Court and all other courts like magistrates courts and sessions court, dealing mainly in criminal matters that covers the economic offenses matters pertaining to the murders and all other. But let us restrict our whole conversation so far as with CAs are concerned, learned part of society, the chartered accountants, which we need very much. I'll restrict my whole whatever today's subject to economic offenses. As Nitin sir was telling, that crime never pays. Yeah, I am of the opinion crime does pay to the lawyers, not to the criminals. But criminals commit crimes for money and pay entire that money on or spend that entire whatever they are earned from that crime. That crime proceeds are used by us lawyers. That is what my opinion is. Anyway, coming to the topic now directly, I personally take this today's subject from your point of view, where I can say that chartered accountants is such people who are required for day-to-day affairs of not like for lawyers, yes, for lawyers, then the main part is the business community, where they are extremely vulnerable, the business community, so far as these police proceedings and court proceedings are concerned. These are called as where in context with which the offenses are committed, which we commonly call is at white-collar crimes, white-collar crimes. Where offense is nothing to do with the red color, where after causing injury the blood comes and then it is called as red issue. But then it is pertaining to white collars are these all learned people who misuse their brains to make money which does not belong to themselves but belongs to somebody else, and to knock out this money. And then one of the sources is, for example, is that obtain loan for business purpose on based on some documents which are subsequently termed, initially they are accepted by the banks, loans are handed over, and then it is revealed that the documents are bogus. For example, now coming from your point of view, the documents like accounts, the first accounts of the company, the companies require substantial amounts for investment or for whatever purpose. Now some are not deserving companies, but still they can get such kind of loans looking at their accounts which are furnished for obtaining the loans. Now these accounts are prepared by chartered accountants, auditors and these people. If the investigation or if that crime is detected, then the investigation starts, and then certainly it reaches to the person, the chartered accountant or the auditor who has actually audited the document and furnished it, and then it becomes a difficult situation for the chartered accountant who otherwise has no connection with the intent of the person or the directors of that company who wanted to make money out of this whole situation. But still the chartered accountants, by virtue of a criminal conspiracy hatched with the main offender, becomes a part of this crime and becomes a co-accused in this matter. Now there, to know all this situation in a brief, I would like to tell you what is basically there are this book which we call criminal manual or 3-in-1 we call it. This is a Bible for all criminal lawyers. Our entire legal system, so far as criminal part is concerned, rests on these three laws. One is Indian Penal Code, IPC, Criminal Procedure Code, CRPC, and third is the Evidence Act, which is Indian Evidence Act. Now, whole system is following these three laws by virtue of which we work in the courts. Now the relevant, so far as today's topic is concerned, is one IPC sections and IPC, basically Indian Penal Code, and the Criminal Procedure Code. As the name suggests, IPC, Indian Penal Code. Indian Penal Code explains under what are the penal provisions in the code which can be used or which can be initiated, under which provisions a person can be brought to the book, brought to books by the investigating agency or the courts as the situation is. That is the guiding feature of, so far as Indian Penal Code is concerned, where, for example, if a person is to be, the most common section is cheating, 420, because we common, in common parlance we use, he is a 420 person. That actually means that he is a cheater. That is what one person wants to say, or he intends to say, that he is a cheater. He is a 420 man. So that is actually a section 420, which says that what under 420 a person can, if found guilty of committing offense of cheating, he can be punished under section 420. Now the Indian Penal Code explains as to under which provision the offence has been committed, in what manner the offence is committed, and if proved, under what provision he can be punished. That indicates the Indian Penal Code. A person who had intention to cheat from inception commits or defrauds a person, knocks out money from him, then he commits a offence of cheating, he can be punished under section 420 of Indian Penal Code. Now to the procedure, what is required to bring him to the books to investigate a matter, then how the court can look at a matter and deal with a matter, and then in under what provision the person can be acquitted or convicted, that whole procedure is explained under CRPC, that is Criminal Procedure Code. As the name suggests, the procedure part of convicting or acquitting is indicated under this, under CRPC, Criminal Procedure Code. Now these are the two main pillars of criminal matters. And then third part, I may point out that the third part of 3-in-1, that is Evidence Act, where the courts have to decide when the trial is in progress, what document or what evidence should be treated as evidence, admissible evidence, and which can be read against the person or in favor of a person. That is guided under Indian Evidence Act. Now, so main subject would be, we'll have to look at CRPC, because the procedure we would like to know about this whole, in this whole conversation. One is, there are two sorts of, when a person wants to approach, if he feels cheated, if a chartered accountant feels that I am cheated by my client by not paying me money or misguiding me, making me incorrect documents or giving me such false information based on which I have created a audit report, which I feel that this is not correct audit report, the chartered accountant must go and lodge a complaint to that effect. The moment he sits over it and says that, all right, it is his baby, let him look into it. If whenever that person will come into trouble, obviously you will be next in the line, because end of the day the person says that, because you will be putting your signature, your stamp, your seal on this audit report, and the investigating agency would surely reach your doorstep to ask you, how did you make this information? The moment you say that, no, this is information given to me by my client, and I was not aware of this. This cannot be the answer, because as a chartered accountant, as an auditor, you have to look into all corresponding material which is placed for you to make the audit report. So if you find that there is some incorrect information given to you, without, now by keeping aside that he is my paying client, you must still go to the police and lodge a complaint, otherwise you will have to pay much more to the lawyers subsequently. So for that, there are two ways you can approach a court or to investigating agency or authority. There are two ways, that is, one is NC, you can register an NC, and you can register a cognizable offense, that is FIR, first information report. Now NC is, just to point out what is NC, when any sort of offense is committed, which cannot be, the CRPC indicates which are offenses which are cognizable in nature, which are not cognizable in nature. That distinction would indicate as to what sort of complaint you have to lodge. Suppose offense which is of non-cognizable nature. For example, if somebody just simpliciter threatens you that you must do this work for me, otherwise I'll see to it that you are taken good care of. Now this is a simpliciter, you can call it a threat. Now threat, giving a threat is not a cognizable offense. If such kind of complaints are lodged, they are treated as NCs, non-cognizable complaints, where police officer has to record this and maintain that in his register, which is meant for registering or maintaining a non-cognizable offenses. But when you come across an offense which is cognizable nature, any serious offense, for that matter, threatening someone at a gunpoint would become a threat, but where a person's life is endangered. So it becomes non-cognizable, it becomes cognizable offense. And if a person shoots in this, though person has not received any injury in that situation, still it would amount to an offense under attempt to murder, because though the person could not receive any bullet injury, but still firing a bullet itself is indicative of a fact that the person intended to kill the person against whom the firing had happened. So serious offenses are treated as cognizable offenses where FIRs are registered. Now police station, if you go to police station and if you convey any fact which indicates any cognizable offense, police is supposed to, and they are under obligation to register that as an FIR. Now the FIRs are registered pursuant to such offenses which are conveyed to police machinery, which are of cognizable nature. Now how it proceeds, that once a cognizable offense is registered, FIR is registered. After FIR is registered, investigation is initiated. The investigating officer has to start with the investigation of that particular case, whether it is a murder case, half murder case, or even for that matter cheating case, forgery case. Now chartered accountants can relate to a case where a person has defrauded a bank in turn has lodged a complaint against the company or that person who has obtained a loan, in turn that person in the invest. So therefore firstly complaint would be registered for cheating and forgery. Now forgery in the sense that if a fake accounts, audited accounts are submitted, it amounts to a forged document, submission of a forged document which have been used to obtain a loan. These documents are submitted, where in that investigation process starts. Once that FIR is registered, investigation starts. During investigation, the investigating officer comes across this document and says that we would like to know whether this audit report is genuine or not, and then it is revealed it is not genuine. Then they would reach to the auditor who has actually done the audit report, and then they would try to find out whether the chartered accountant is involved in this whole fudging of this audit or whether he was also misguided. But chances are very high where the police officers or these investigating officers come to a conclusion, know that the chartered accountant is involved in this matter, because it is presumed that you have gone through all those documents and then created a audit report. So therefore that this is part of investigation which is conducted by these various investigating agencies. Now generally I must tell you that these offenses nowadays, looking at the amounts and figures what are spoken about all over the society, whatever is above 50 lakhs is investigated. If a fraud is above 50 lakhs is investigated by economic offenses wing. There is a separate wing where officers who are having knowledge into looking at to the accounts and all these issues, they are specifically deployed to look into these offenses. There is a separate unit to that effect, and that unit is called as economic offenses wing. They look into these issues. where a person involved, then there is one more part of it in this whole investigation. If a bank officer is also involved, then one more provision is added besides this Indian Penal Code, that is Prevention of Corruption Act. If a person, suppose a nationalized bank officer, manager, if he is involved in this whole process of sanctioning loan and all, then he also becomes a co-accused, and being one of the person being a government servant, Prevention of Corruption Act is also involved. Now, so far as these rest sections are concerned, where the investigation if revealed that offence is committed by a private individual, then offence, and if offence is like 420, 465, that is cheating, forgery, these sections, then the charge sheet, the final report after the entire investigation is over, a final report is submitted to the magistrate's court. Now there are three courts basically which are at this level, at the state level. Firstly, the lowest in the category is the magistrate's court. Above that is the court of sessions, and above that is a high court. Now, when these kind of charge sheets are filed, where only IPC sections are involved, the charge sheet is always filed in the magistrate's court. That is the lowest possible court. After the magistrate's court charge sheet is filed, if the magistrate court or else other I may point out at this juncture itself, if besides IPC, Indian Penal Code, if the Prevention of Corruption Act is also involved, then it's being a special statute, a special law. The magistrate is not does not have any jurisdiction to entertain such complaints. So the charge sheets are filed directly to the Court of Sessions, which are called as special courts dealing in prevention of corruption matters. So all those offences which are otherwise triable by the magistrates are then tried by the Sessions Court, because there is additional section or additional Act of Prevention of Corruption Act. Because there is an involvement of one of the bank officer who is an officer of some nationalized bank or a government-aided bank. In that situation, the cognizance is taken by the Sessions Court. No charge sheets are ever filed in High Courts, because High Court does not have original jurisdiction now on criminal side. And then the matter either goes ahead in the Magistrates Court or in Sessions Court, where the defenses are to be raised by the accused. And prosecution has to prove his case in the Magistrates Court or in Sessions Court. Now, during this whole period where the investigation is going on, there are one more issues as to how a accused who is accused of committing such offence, he is to be his liberty is to be secured, or how it can be looked into by the courts. Now, that is the stage where we can request the court for granting bail or anticipatory bail. That is, if a person is yet not arrested, we can always request for bail in anticipation of his arrest in that particular crime. For example, if a person, a chartered accountant, if allegations are made in such kind of investigation by Economic Offences Wing or the regular agency, if the fraud is below 50 lakhs, in that situation, if such inquiry, you generally, they, in this Economic Offences Wing, unlike these murder cases, police don't rush into your house overnight and pick you up. There they give you sufficient opportunity. They send you firstly a notice indicating as to you are aware as to what are the facts of this case which we are investigating. Please furnish us the details or the documents as the case may be. Sometimes they also come at your place, they can search your premises, they can see some documents which are concerning the whole issue where in respect of which the investigation is going on. Even that powers investigating agency does have it. In that situation, if a person receives such notice, certainly looking at the situation or the way the investigations are going on, lawyers can understand as to what is happening, whether there is a possibility of arrest or it is simply sitter investigation which is being carried out without arresting a person. Now, I have seen many cases in last 15 years where CBI people, CBI is one agency, it's called as one of the most premium agency, investigating agency in India. Now, CBI people do not arrest in such kind of offences till the charge sheets are filed, and they generally, but this is a general trend which is being followed by CBI. But private, not private, local police stations, they are very much interested in arresting people. They are more interested in arresting people than investigating. That is my personal opinion, by the way. Then economic offenses also, that to certain extent they don't jump onto these professionals like chartered accountants and all. They are also aware that end of the day they are not end beneficiaries of the crime unless they come across some major material indicating the person's involvement. But they do send some notice to the chartered accountants indicating that such and such investigation is going on. We are of the opinion that you are aware of some facts of this matter and please come and furnish that to us. And you can contact. They generally nowadays they are kind enough to give their contact details and all. They ask you take our appointment and come and meet us. So many times looking at the background of the matter and all, if there are any arrest effected, we generally advise that if no arrest have happened till date of the main person who has obtained the bail, then we advise you go and give whatever information. But if the main person is arrested, we generally ask them, let us go secure your liberty first, seek some interim relief to you, that in event of your arrest you should be released, and then go to the investigating agency and then furnish all details whatever they want. Now that is the stage where you are yet to be arrested, but you apprehend that in case if I go there, I have furnished these details furnished this audit report. By using this audit report, he has obtained or defrauded the bank, then there is a possibility that I would be arrested. In that situation, we advise that, all right, let us go to the court, point out that I am a chartered accountant. I have no business to do with so far as the main offender is concerned. He has defrauded the bank. I am merely a chartered accountant. I have carried out the audit report based on the material furnished to me, and I am not concerned with this. In that case, generally the courts are also aware that they are professionals. In that situation, they give us interim protection that in the event of your arrest in connection with this so and so crime, you should be released forthwith, but on a condition that you must cooperate with the investigating agency. Now that is called as interim anticipatory bail, and if during this interim period, if we cooperate and if we succeed to point out that I am not concerned with this whole main crime, then anticipatory bails are also granted. Now once that anticipatory bails are granted, till your trial is over or till you are completely exonerated of this case, you still remain to be on bail in that kind of matters. Now if a situation arises that a person is actually arrested, then the option before him is to secure a regular bail where he is already in custody, he is presented before a magistrate or the sessions court, as the case may be. If prevention of corruption at sessions court, if regular IPC offences, before a magistrate, he is presented before them. In that situation, the person is initially remanded. Now let me also point out what are the rights of the investigating agency also. If a person is produced before the magistrate or the sessions court, as the case may be, the person can be remanded to police custody where they get direct access to the person to interrogate him, to question him with the documents and all sorts of issues which are concerning the investigation. Now for that purpose, the magistrates can grant police custody up to 15 days at a stretch. At the most 15 days they get. Beyond that, they cannot grant any sort of police custody. Thereafter, the person has to be remanded to judicial custody. Once the person is remanded to judicial custody, the option is to apply for regular bail and obtain a bail from the magistrate's court. If not granted, then you can again present a bail application before a higher court, that is sessions court. If there also, if it is rejected, then to high court. And if not, in the fourth court which comes into play, that is Supreme Court. Because there is this is only the four, there is no reviews available under the criminal procedure code. So, but certainly there is no bar in reapplying bail, like in an appeal, where you must be aware of these appeals, where first appeal, second appeal against the authorities they pass about the tax liabilities which you generally represent your clients, where first appeal is allowed and second appeal is allowed before the authority. third appeal subject to correction from all these people. And third appeal is to the High Court Division Bench and all these things. Likewise, there is no such provision under the criminal law of second, third and fourth appeal. But certainly for bail applications, there is no such bar. But only the requirement is that there has to be some change in the circumstance. No court can stop you from filing bail applications every day. But it does not make any sense, because from yesterday till today, there is no such change of circumstance where the same judge can refuse you bail yesterday and can grant you bail today. So that a logic can prevail, I understand, that a person can apply for bail with a change of circumstance. Now, these are the two ways we can secure liberty. Either in anticipation of our arrest, we can seek relief, or else if arrested, post-arrest, a regular bail. There are also offences where which are registered beyond the jurisdiction where you are residing or where you are working, your occupation or professional offices and all. Like for example, if some offence is registered at Delhi, where Delhi Economic Offences Wing is investigating a matter, and if you come across such kind of summons to appear before the investigating agency, you generally have no clue as to what is to be done. I don't know anyone in Delhi. Now, what do I do in Delhi? If I go there to answer some queries and if I get arrested, what do I do? In that situation, there is a provision of transit anticipatory bail. That is only for a limited purpose, like if a person where the judges in local jurisdiction do not go in much into the allegations, certainly they look into that, they look only to the extent that this is worth granting anticipatory bail. That much, yes, any judge will look into it. Like a very serious murder offense, the judge may not entertain such prayer. But in such kind of matters where economic offenses are there, generally if a jurisdiction is far beyond your reach, where you cannot reach within 24 hours or so, then transit anticipatory bails are granted, where you are protected for a period of say 15 days, 20 days, as the case may be, considering the situation involved. And during that period, in case if you are arrested in that offense which is under investigation at that whichever place, at Delhi or Nagpur or wherever, you can be released on bail subject to whatever terms imposed or conditions imposed. And thereafter, the requirement is that you have to go before or subject yourself to the court or the agency where the offense is being investigated and secure appropriate relief from the local court. That is, only it's a stopgap arrangement where a person should be given an access or he should be given a passage to reach an appropriate authority, for which this transit anticipatory bail provision is there. There is also a case where if a person is actually arrested beyond jurisdiction, then police are required to take him by taking permission of a local jurisdiction. For example, if a person is arrested in Mumbai in connection with an offence which is registered at Delhi, then the person has to be presented before a local magistrate saying that we have arrested a person at Mumbai. He is the person. We want his custody in Delhi court. So grant us. The magistrate can grant transit custody, that is transit custody where he can be given that by tomorrow, by within 24 hours, you have to produce him before the appropriate court. This is one aspect of it. Now from defense side, if a person is arrested in such situation, he can be even released on bail, which is called as transit bail. Even a person can be released on transit bail where he assures the court that I will appear before the concerned court within 2 days, 3 days, whatever the situation may be. So certain conditions can be imposed and a person can be released on transit anticipatory bail. Now, okay, there is one of the issues while this investigation is going on. So one of the queries, whether can I have my lawyer present in an inquiry or interrogation by the police? The answer is yes, but with a rider to that a lawyer should not, basically the investigating officer has to be given free hand to investigate a matter. What is the job of lawyer if he is allowed? There is one very famous judgment of one Nandini Satpati. where a person or a lady was arrested and she was being subjected to some harassment. This police were assaulting her and all. So a request was made to the High Court and then to the Supreme Court that allow my lawyer to remain present in this whole interrogation process because they are using unwarranted actions to give me some or make me or force me to give some confession, which I am not interested to do. The Supreme Court allowed that request and said that yes, the lawyer can be allowed to remain present, only that he should not interfere in the investigation. Now, not interfering means what? That if the question is put to you, put to the accused or a suspect, then and suspect is answering, the lawyer cannot go and say, no, this question you cannot put, that question you cannot put, you ask about that and this and all this. This interference is certainly not permitted by the lawyer. But lawyer can ensure that no such third degree tactics and all are used by the police against him. Now, only to that extent lawyer can certainly be present with the suspect or his client. Now, there is one more issue as to many a times it happens that the common question is put to me or my colleague that, sir, can you send somebody, one of your person, I'm going to police station. So we generally send them that, yes, you go to with him and see what happens. Now, that is for two reasons why I say that. One is that, first and foremost, from client's point of view, that he is like, all right, my lawyer is there. He would do some miracle there, which generally does not happen. Police, they want to arrest him, they still arrest him, and in fact they get annoyed the moment they see any lawyer in their cabin. So they generally don't like it. But at the same time, one thing happens. These police are very mischievous, according to me. What they do, that the person is summoned to the police station, that poor person goes to the police station, next day they present him before the magistrate with a wonderful story saying that we had created one trap at one place and how we had to nab him, so many police officers team was there and we had to raid that one premises. That poor person gets fed up, yesterday I had come to your police station, I was in the police station, what nonsense you are talking. But then unfortunately there is no record. Now, to tackle this situation, certainly we say that, all right, you go with him, take one letter, that person to your request, my client is present with me. Now, once the lawyer comes, they are under check. They don't create these kind of stories to show that how brilliant police officers they are. So, for that purpose, lawyers can certainly accompany the clients. Now, there is one more thing. About the cheque part, cheques, bouncing of cheques, because this is also economic offences issue pertaining to it. Bouncing of cheque is also considered as economic offence, which my learned friend would deal with it because he's far better than what I understand in this cheque bouncing cases. I always take his advices. So he will deal with that of the issue, which would be very interesting to hear about. Now, these are the basic economic offences where chartered accountants, as I said, are involved in the offences, where police would like to implicate you professionals in this kind of matters. Now, as I said, just to sum up the issue, that whenever this acquittal is recorded or a conviction is recorded, there is always a provision to challenge acquittal or conviction as the case may be. If a person is acquitted, the state has a right to challenge that, a private party has a right to challenge it. If a person is convicted, obviously the person would like to challenge such conviction because that always acts as stigma against a person, so he can challenge it in a higher court, that if a magistrate convicts, the appeal would lie to the court of sessions. If sessions court convicts, appeal would lie to the high court, and so on so forth. And even the last option is before the Supreme Court. Now, this is how the appeals are filed. There are various issues involved in this, but I would restrict only to a general provisions so far as these issues are concerned. Now, there are ways to approach a court. That is, sometimes it happens that if you go to a police station, sometimes they say that no, you, this is all civil dispute, you go to file a civil suit. This is a general advice which the police officers generally they give, because they are not interested to deal with these economic offences, unless it is an economic offences thing. But firstly, you cannot, and one more thing I would like to cover, that you cannot directly go to economic offences wing. That wing comes into play by two ways. One is pursuant to direction of some authority, or pursuant to a transfer of some case to them. Like if you feel that you are aggrieved that I am cheated for an offence which is beyond 50 crores, you have to go to a local police station. The local police station looks at the issue, and if they find that this seems to be some scam, then they refer that very FIR to the economic offences wing, the concerned economic offences wing. That wing will then take over the investigation and investigate the matter. But sometimes, even though these complaints are presented before the police, they don't accept that. In that situation, there is a provision under the CRPC, that is Criminal Procedure Code, where you can go to a magistrate's court, file a private complaint. A private complaint would be treated by the magistrate, and if apparently case is made out, he can directly take cognizance of the matter and say that, all right, I'm issuing process against these accused. So that means I'm summoning people, those named as accused before the court. Sometimes the magistrate can form an opinion that no, this requires some investigation purpose. Some investigation is necessary in looking at these facts what are narrated in the complaint. The magistrate has two ways to deal with it. One, either direct police to register FIR and investigate and ask them to file a report to that effect. Now, asking them to register FIR gives a much wider scope to the investigating agency, because the moment FIR is registered, they get authority to arrest a person without any warrant. So that direction can be given. Or else, there is one more provision where a magistrate can ask a police officer or any person who is having knowledge in that particular topic to make inquiry in the matter and submit a report to that effect. Generally, the trend is that it is given to the police only to make inquiry and submit report. After that report is received, the magistrate can look into or agree with the report or disagree with the report. If a positive report is filed, that means if a report is filed indicating that there is an offence made out, then the magistrate can look into that, agree with that report and summon accused. Or else if a negative report is filed, that is no offence is made out, in that situation the magistrate can agree with that, then call the complainant saying that a negative report is filed, tell us what do you want to say further. And then magistrate can form still same opinion or have a contrary opinion and still summon the accused. Now these are the ways where you can secure some orders where investigations can be done either directly by police or pursuant to directions from the magistrate by the police. Now these are the ways you can get the matters investigated. There is also one more last issue about this whole investigation purpose, is that these magistrates cannot direct economic offences wing or CBI, these kind of agencies, to investigate a matter. They can at the most direct the local police station within their jurisdiction to investigate a matter. If you want economic offences wing to investigate or a CBI to investigate the matter, you have only one option, is to approach the High Court under writ jurisdiction and seek such relief that the local police are not doing the job properly. My allegations pertain to a very big scam, and this requires some consideration from some eminent agency otherwise than a police, local police, where the High Court has powers or is empowered to direct that a CBI can grant or CBI can look into this kind of investigation, or a crime branch or economic offences wing, which otherwise this jurisdiction the magistrate would not have. I think this is the way that economic offences are looked at. Now let my learned friend complete the check bouncing part of it, or anything to be added to that, and then in case any issues are to be, or questions, any queries, then we can answer them.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Hi friends, I guess you guys have got to know quite a lot on how the court systems and the different courts work. But check bouncing is one thing where everyone thinks that a check has bounced and an offense is immediately done by the person whose check has bounced. Well, technically, that's not the correct way of looking at it, because mere just bouncing of a check does not make that person an offender. The offense is not committed by only when a check is given and it's bounced. So there are various procedures which have to be followed, and then an offense is created. So that's the common thing everyone says, that okay, this check bounced and it's taken me years to prosecute someone. But unfortunately, that's how it works. There are courts now which are moving faster, but it's going to take some more time till things get streamlined. Well, everyone must be shocked that I said that once the check bounces, the offense is still not committed. So that's where I would start my whole thing today, to enlighten. Once a check is bounced, you can't just directly approach a police station or a court to register a complaint. One, because it's not a cognizable offense. And two, I mean to say, when I say that it's not a cognizable offense, that means the police cannot register an FIR. A common thing is everyone thinks that why am I not going to the police and registering an FIR for a bounced check? Well, you can register an FIR, but not for the check being bounced. You can register an FIR for cheating and whatever the other things which have a criminal breach of trust. All those things are open to you, provided those ingredients are there in your complaint. But the case, the Negotiable Instrument Act being non-cognizable, you have to approach the magistrate court and seek permission of the magistrate. Now, to approach a magistrate also, first, once the check bounces, you have to make sure that you give a notice to the person who has given you the check. Within 30 days from when the check has bounced. Even if you cross, you give the notice on the 32nd day or 31st day, the whole case would go bad. So you have to give a notice within 30 days and make sure that you don't file the case. You have to give a notice saying that asking for payment back within 15 days of receipt of the notice. Now, asking for payment, strictly speaking, as far as the notice under 138, which is contemplated, is you have to ask for the check amount which is on the check. I'll give you an example. Suppose I owe you guys 1 lakh rupees. I give you a check of 50,000 and that bounces. So notice which has to come to me has to be for the specific amount of 50,000, not for your entire outstanding. You may include that, but a specific demand has to be made for that check. And until unless that specific demand is made, the offense is not complete. Now, to complete the offense, once the demand is made, and if the payment is not made to you within the 15 days period, the offense is committed on the 16th day. So the cause of action arises only on the 16th day. So if someone gives you a check and it bounces, and you send a notice, and the payment is made to you within those 15 days, there's no offense made out against that person under the Negotiable Instrument Act. So if someone chooses to go and file a complaint after receiving the payment, saying that, so what, the check has bounced, that complaint will not be maintainable. Now coming to the main aspects is, whenever a check is given and it bounces and you comply with all these provisions, there's a presumption which is fortunately there for all the people, because normally the criminal law says that you have to prove him guilty. Well, the presumption here is that the check is given to you for a legally enforceable liability. So if the person whose check, we call them the accused. So if the accused check, which has bounced, and he wants to disprove it, there's a presumption against him that the check is given for a legally enforceable liability, and he has to rebut that presumption. And until unless he successfully does that, the courts will hold that he is liable to pay you. So this normally happens when in cases where someone takes a loan and gives a post-dated check, and a lot of times loans are repaid but PDCs are not returned back. What must one do is, the minute someone misuses the check and you receive a notice, you must reply to it, because that would come on to your first, at the very first instance, you have tried to rebut the presumption. Now coming on to who can be prosecuted. Well, if it's an individual who's given you a check, there's no one else who can be prosecuted but that individual. But in cases where a company or a partnership firm gives you a check, the people who can be prosecuted are all the people who are responsible and are in charge of the day-to-day affairs, and with whose connivance and consent this whole act has happened. The common nowadays, what happens is, when a company gives a check and it bounces, notice is sent, and the cases are filed, they go up, look up on the ROC website and check out the list of directors. That includes a lot of full-time directors, it includes independent directors, the ones who are professional directors who are nominated from various institutions to be on the board. They include everyone. And what does the magistrate see? He sees that, okay, you have filed a complaint, you've named the directors, he issues a process. And a summons reaches all the directors. Now, mainly most of the directors who are the professional directors, independent directors, they all panic. They say, well, I am not responsible, why is this summons coming to me? Well, things are settled now, there's no reason to panic. These are mainly done to pressurize the companies. Well, if you can prove that you are an independent director by way of your designation and the Form 32 which is filed, you can always approach the court and get yourself exonerated before the trial happens. But you can't approach the same magistrate for that, because once the magistrate issues a process, he cannot recall his own order. That's the law. So you have to move the higher court by way of a revision in the sessions court and challenge that order, saying that this is not obtained in the correct fashion. Now the complainant would normally try to defend that situation, that no, they are responsible. Now, there are various guidelines laid down by the Supreme Court in various judgments where who can be prosecuted, although he's a director. Now, there are various categories. The first category is the managing director of a company. There is no escape route, he has to be prosecuted. Whether he'll be convicted or no, that depends on how the trial proceeds. But there's no need of any averment in the complaint. Merely stating that he is the managing director of the company, that's more than sufficient to prosecute him. Now, there's a reason behind it, because the word managing director, it shows that yes, he is one of the persons who's primarily responsible for the company. He looks after all the affairs of the company. The other person who cannot escape out would be the signatory of the check. So again, if you don't make any direct allegations in your complaint that so-and-so is responsible for this act in this whole transaction, but you mention that A has signed the check and he's responsible, that's more than sufficient, because the fact that the dishonored check was signed by him, that shows that he is holding a key post in the company and he's responsible for the finances of the company. So these two people cannot be exonerated without a trial. But if merely we make 10 directors of the company a party without showing any role, what is done by each one of them, we just say that so-and-so to so-and-so are the directors of the company and hence you should prosecute them. Normally, the magistrates now don't issue process. But still, there are cases when people have got processes issued. So the option then to those people who may not be independent directors, who may not be non-executive directors, they do look after some part of the affairs of the company, but they are not directly involved in the finance, they are not directly involved in the same transactions. They can also approach the higher court and show the court that, see, the complaint doesn't disclose of any direct allegation against the particular directors. And hence, they can also be exonerated before the trial. Now, everyone says check bouncing cases go on for a long time. Why should we get into all this? Because it goes on for years and years. Well, that's not the case always. It all depends on how one deals with it and how one is diligent about it. There are various stages in which a trial proceeds in a check bouncing case. Everyone says, oh, that case is filed against him. He went to court. Why he came back home? He should have been arrested, put behind bars. That's the whole psychology which moves around among people who are not aware about how the system works. Well, the offense is a bailable offense. So primarily, you can't be put behind bars straight away, because what does a bailable offense mean? A bailable offense means that minute you are arrested or whatever for any reason, you should grant it bail. Now, appearing before a court also technically means that you are in the custody of the court when you are summoned. So you have to obtain a bail. So how does the criminal trial of a 138 case work is, there are various stages. First being that the check has to bounce, because without that you can't proceed. then you got to give a notice. Once the notice is given, you have to wait for the 15 days. Once that is done, there's a rider that you have to file the complaint within 1 month. From the time the cause of action arises, that is the 16th day after which the notice has received, is being received by the accused, you have to file the complaint within 1 month. Now at times you may miss it. There is a provision where you can apply, which used to not be there earlier, but the act was amended because a lot of people missed that 1 month. So the act was then amended by getting in a provision for condonation of delay. So now, if you can show a reasonable ground that, okay, I missed my 1 month is because of X, Y, and Z reason, and if the magistrate is satisfied with what is got before them, then he may grant you the permission and allow you the complaint to move ahead. Now, once the complaint is filed, that's not the end. Merely filing a complaint doesn't end the role of the complainant. The role of the complainant has to be there throughout till his evidence is done with. So the first stage would come, his examination before the magistrate, even before the accused is summoned, the magistrate will examine him on oath and verify whatever is written. He'll verify whether you have deposited the check within its validity. Earlier it used to be 6 months, now it's 3 months. He'll also verify the reason for it being dishonored, whether it is for insufficient funds, exceeds funds. There are some times where certain reasons are there which is beyond the control of the person who has issued the check. A lot of times it comes that payment stopped because the accused has filed with his bankers stop payment request. Those options are still there for the magistrate to look into it and issue process. So he'll verify whether the reason is correct. He'll also verify whether you have sent the notice on time, that is within the 30 days. And then whether the notice is received or not, or whether you have sent it to the correct address. Now that one would say, how would he verify? Normally it's done by looking at the notice, the face of the notice and the complaint. So that's how he would check. Because a lot of time people show that they have sent notice to X address, but they file the complaint on Y address. So that just to create a mischief, people who do that as not always, but a prudent person would never do that. These are done by people who just file these cases for harassment purpose or stuff like that. So he verifies those aspects. And then he also checks whether you file the complaint within time. Now once that is done, normally the magistrate issues the process. But in certain cases, he conducts an inquiry. Now there was an amendment to the CRPC. The inquiry is conducted under section 202 of the CRPC, where it's discretionary upon the magistrate to conduct an inquiry when the accused is residing within his jurisdiction. But the amendment has come that he shall conduct an inquiry when the accused is residing beyond his jurisdiction. So there's an inquiry conducted. Normally, these cases are not sent for police inquiry, like my learned friend informed, that at times the magistrate sends it for inquiry and then a report is filed. He basically inquires with the complainant to find out what were the documents, what was your transaction, verifies that, and then he would issue, normally he would issue process. Now in cases where the magistrate finds that things are not correct, what is written in the complaint is totally different than what is on fact, on paper, by verifying the original, he would dismiss the complaint. But once everything is okay, the magistrate issues a summons. Now, these summons have to be sent to the accused. That's the time when the role of the accused starts in the matter. Till then, it's only the complainant who attends the court, because the accused is not aware also. The first time he gets aware is when the summons are reaching him. Now, once the summons reach a person, what he does, there are two options. Either he appears or he doesn't. It's always advisable to appear, because if you don't, and the report comes that the summons is reached, which normally would come to the magistrate before next date, the complainant can ask for a warrant. Now, normally these accused, who are seasoned criminals, we call them, because there are a lot of people who have a number of matters going on. They know what the system works. They normally first one or two dates avoid to attend so that they can buy out some more time. So a warrant is issued to secure their presence. Now once all the warrant and all is done, he comes back. He comes to the court, the accused. The first thing the he has to secure is a bail. Now that amount is totally discretionary on the magistrate, what bail he should grant. Normally, in cheque bouncing cases, nominal bail is granted, because the magistrates also take a lenient view as to, but there are some courts, obviously, they are now granting you bail based on what the amount of the cheque is. So once that bail is granted, the plea of the accused is recorded. Now, what is a plea? A question is put to you. There are a couple of two or three questions put to you, that whether you received the complaint and whether you plead guilty. Now, once if a person says, yes, I plead guilty, the option with the magistrate is to convict him. And what is the maximum conviction which can be levied is twice the amount of the cheque. Maximum is 2 years imprisonment, twice the amount of the cheque, or both. But in cases, normally what we have been seeing is normally 6 months to a year, depending on the quantum. And they don't, until unless it's a very gross case that, you know, deliberately and things like that, then they normally go to twice the amount of the cheque. But it's a little nominal value above the cheque is given as compensation. But if the accused, normally what the accused does is he pleads not guilty. And then is the stage when the trial starts. The trial doesn't start till the plea is not recorded. Now, in cases where there are more than one accused, it's a company, couple of directors, or a firm and its partners, you require all the accused to be present at the same time to record the plea. So the plea is postponed if one of them is also not present. So this is also another modus operandi which is used to delay the process of recording of plea. Because unless the plea is recorded, the charges are not framed against you, the trial cannot move ahead. And there are times where the magistrate can grant the accused exemption from appearance once the bail is secured. So people do take advantage of that situation and delay the trial. Now once the plea is recorded, then one has to file its evidence. Earlier that evidence had to be oral. There was no provision to file an affidavit, and the evidence had to be recorded in oral by leading examination in chief, and then the complainant was subjected to cross-examination. Now to curtail that whole process, the act has again been amended, and the complainant is allowed to file his evidence by way of an affidavit. So the entire process of leading an oral evidence and the time-consuming process is curtailed by filing an affidavit and the documents which the complainant is relying upon. There are some times where normally the complainant is the main witness in this case because he covers all the points, but there are some times where there are few ambiguities and stuff, so a couple of more witnesses are to be examined in them. That also delays the whole trial, but sometimes you have to prove what you are trying to, so you have to examine those witnesses. There's no way you can get away. Now once the complainant examines his set of witness, like I don't know if someone's been to a civil trial where you have a chance to cross-examine the defendant, that option is not there in a criminal trial. The accused has the right to remain silent if he wants to. The magistrate records, once the whole evidence of the complainant is over, the magistrate would then put forward questions to the accused, which is recorded. That's called the statement under section 313 of the CRPC, where he'll put forward questions to form his opinion based on the evidence led by the complainant. It's after that stage that the accused has a right to decide whether he wants to step into the witness box and lead evidence, or he wants to adduce evidence through others to prove that the money owed is not payable. So he has that right, but per se the complainant cannot force him, no, you get into the witness box and I want to cross-examine you because you grilled me. So that right the complainant doesn't have under the criminal procedure. Now once the defense witness is over, or the accused chooses not to examine any defense witness, then the matter reaches to the argument stage and then goes on to the judgment stage. So all these processes take a little time, and the courts in Mumbai are at the moment quite overburdened with number of cases. We hope in recent time now the burden is going to come down, because there's one more aspect. The Act doesn't talk about jurisdiction. So it's based on presumption that where the Act, now there are five ingredients which commit that Act, which is first the cheque has to return. First the cheque has to be deposited in a bank to return. Then it has to be returned by the bank. Notice has to be sent. Payment is not made. And the cheque is issued for some purpose. So normally everyone took jurisdiction based on a landmark judgment passed in 1999, which was known as the judgment, which was K. Bhaskaran, where everyone followed guidelines in that judgment and filed cases. Well, everyone took as the place where the complainant is carrying on business or resides, the bank where the complainant's bank is, the bank where the accused bank is, and place from where notice is sent. Because notice is an important ingredient. So that's where all the mischief started. Now there were major, there were people who concentrated, like banks. They gave loans to all over. And they concentrated that, okay, we will deposit all the checks in Mumbai in a particular area. So that court used to have 10,000 matters of one complainant. And people from all over used to come, they used to be summoned. And most of the cases, they were small cases, like banks normally have credit card cases, and those amounts, they get settled very fast. So person normally who comes from far settles it. Now this issue was a common issue which was prevailing. And to some extent it was correct also. Why should the complainant run behind the accused? The accused should come where the complainant is. But this issue was also misused a lot. Because people entered into a loan transaction somewhere in Calcutta. Bank had the head office in Delhi. And they had a corporate office in Mumbai. Started using that the loan is issued from the corporate office. They used to have the disbursement always from the corporate office. So they created the jurisdiction of Mumbai. Now a person living in Calcutta, the minute he has to come to Mumbai, if he was a prudent man, he would say, I would rather settle it and finish it off. I don't want to get into all this mess. There was few people who challenged this issue. Because they said that the check has bounced in our bank. My bank has refused to pay. So the offense ingredients happened in Calcutta, not in Mumbai or Delhi, or checks were even deposited in some other third city, but because corporate office was in Mumbai and loan was given from Mumbai, the case was filed in Mumbai. Then came an issue. People started feeling the pinch, especially the major defaulters or even genuine people. They like to challenge that issue. Why should we travel all the way? Because check is deposited in a second city and case is filed in a third. This also happened for reasons. Like people started filing cases outside Maharashtra and Madhya Pradesh, to be specific, because there came an amendment that court fees would be levied. Now, in Maharashtra, we have a court fees of 2% with the maximum of 1.5 lakh rupees. Now, 2% is rounded up to the nearest 200 rupees per 10,000. That's how they calculate. So to avoid paying the court fees, what people started doing is opening an account somewhere outside Maharashtra and depositing checks there. So entire transaction has taken place here, but just because someone has opened an account somewhere in Delhi, he goes to Gurgaon and files the case there because he says, my bank is in Delhi, Gurgaon. There was a series of litigation between various parties which finally came before the Supreme Court. And on 1st August 2014, this year, the Supreme Court has passed a landmark judgment overturning the ratio laid down by the earlier bench of which decided the case of K. Bhaskaran. Now that was the bench of the Supreme Court. This is a full bench where three judges sit. So that has more weightage. So they overturned that judgment and said, no, all these things don't prevail. Ideally, check is bounced where the accused bank is. Because complainant bank cannot bounce the check. The check has to be bounced for insufficient funds or whatever reasons is where the bank of the accused is there. So you have to file those cases only where within the jurisdiction where the bank of the accused is there. So all speculations as to the remaining four ingredients are all laid to rest now. Complainant may be carrying on business wherever. His bank may be wherever. Wherever you have sent the notice form is not material. But where the bank of the accused is, that is material. Because the offense has happened only because the check has bounced, which has bounced at the bank of the accused. So all the speculation of filing cases X, Y, Z, and the Supreme Court also, what they said that yes, we understand this judgment will have impact on a lot of cases which are pending. But they chose to have the effect of the judgment retrospective. Because they said, why should an accused suffer just because the judgment was not there before? But they also laid a rider that cases which have passed a certain stage, that where cross-examination has begun, those cases would be deemed to be transferred to where they are. Remaining complaints, they are not dismissed. They are returned back to the complainant to be filed in appropriate jurisdiction. So this whole judgment of 1st August has created a major turbulence in the whole system, especially financial institutions who file bulk cases. It has so happened that I won't name them, but I was speaking to an MD of an important company. He said, what we did with 12 lawyers, now we have to employ 250 lawyers. He said that because the loans are spread all over and the checks are bouncing from various parts of the country, now there's no other option. But so now the law now is that if an accused gives you a check, someone gives you a check by an accused, the safeguards what one should do should see first where the check is issued from. So we've been advising all our clients who come with the bounce checks that X and Y have given me checks. We look, tell him now, henceforth business is going to suffer, but henceforth please try to do business where you can reach. So that's how the system works. And that's the reason why people talk about trial taking so long, but there are various stages involved. I'll put it up to you guys if you have any question to ask us. At par, Bombay High Court did pass a judgment in August, around 25th of August, saying that at par, yes, although this issue was clarified earlier by a division bench ruling also, that at par is where the city, especially in intercity, but that judgment has been now stayed by the Supreme Court. That matter is under challenge, should be coming up in the next week, but probably it will still take some time for that to be.
In the financial agreement, it is given as to what jurisdiction in Bombay.
Yes, because you may prosecute for other offences, for a civil or cheating, whatever you can do it. Suppose your agreement says Bombay, but your cheque is issued at Delhi. You can prosecute him for other offences in Bombay, but for negotiable instrument act, you have to go to Delhi.
Cheque, not a crime.
No, it all depends where your return memo comes from. So there are certain cooperative banks which have the core banking facility. So again, the memo, it depends from where your return memo comes. But that is also at the moment stayed by the Supreme Court. So it's safer to use the address of the bank.
The question for Niranjan is, Chartered Accountancy offers services to the client. So it is like successors are assigned to the client, assigned to the client. In the criminal cases, like, you know, normally it happens like a succession or will, all these cases. Do the heirs of the legatee of that party, our client, you know, sometimes they say this CA cheated us, he better for us. So whether they get the workers' credit is there with them, file the case.
Basically, I want to ask you whether the legal heir can also initiate a complaint against
criminal
complaint against chartered accountants. Basically, I tell you, anyone can set law in motion. Whether a person who is cheated, who himself is cheated, or even a person feels that my father was cheated by his chartered accountant or his lawyer, still he can initiate a complaint. There is no such bar that being a legal heir, he is not directly concerned with the cheated person, or he being just a legal heir, he cannot initiate action. Anyone can set law in motion. So, complaint can be lodged. A face of that complaint would be a different issue altogether. But anyone can say it not. One of the SEBI was also in this whether IP offences, then copyright offences, information technology act, whether such offences are nowadays, these are also offences which need to be tackled with because they are cognizable offences and they are generally where it is not cognizable, they couple it with cheating case 420. End of the day, copyright was misused for the purpose of cheating. That is how IPC offences is what and they made it a non or cognizable or non deliverable offence. That was one of the
Sir, I have a query in respect of the bonds check. Yeah. After that 16th day deadline, being opinion in nature of this matter, is arbitration possible after that 16th day?
Arbitration
will be
only
if
both sides are
agreed.
That has no bearing on
bank bonds. But our understanding is that arbitration is normally not possible, normally, in criminal matters. So, any deliberate?
Normally, both arbitration is only possible if both sides are agreeable or there is an arbitration clause in your transaction.
No, but this is a simply check bouncing.
No, there is no arbitration then because there is no understanding that, yes, in case the offense happens, we can approach the arbitrator. There is no understanding about that. We cannot get into arbitration. You only recourse for a bounce check. Would be filing a complaint before the minister.
Even if both parties agree, you still cannot.
You can always have arbitration between both parties.
There is party agreement,
always settlement.
Payable at bar checks, the Western Court is still taking the provision that okay, check is payable at bar, it will be continued.
They are taking the complaint. But they are not taking any action on the complaint. They are taking the complaint so that your limitation is not missed out. Your 1 month limitation to file the complaint.
No, what they are doing is, suppose drawing bank is someone, if that bank is having the branch in that jurisdiction or check is at payable at par, so that court is saying, okay, I am having the jurisdiction because the other payable at other branch of that same bank is in my jurisdiction.
Well, this issue is still pending before the Supreme Court. There's every magistrate has his own opinion. In Bombay also, there are certain magistrates who are not at all entertaining at par. And there are certain courts which are saying, okay, you file it. And we'll see, we'll let the Supreme Court decide. There are even certain courts, like if it's within Bombay, let us give you an example that if I give a check of Bandra. You have a check of Bandra, you deposit it in
church.
At church gate. Your return memo comes from council.
Right.
finding at least from the Supreme Court judgment, you have to go to Bandar.
Right.
But because the return memo was from Fountain,
right,
and it is payable at par, so the bank which has issued is a memo in the central clearing agency of the bank,
right,
it will approach the court which is in the jurisdiction of Fountain.
Right.
But those complaints also mentioned are just filing it so that the limitation is there. They are not taking much action on it. Although there is a section under section 63 of the CRPC where the magistrate has power over the entire Mumbai area. But then again, that is bifurcated because the CMM has distinguished their allocation. So that's how it's being read. But that issue is still not...
Very much confusion is going on this issue.
That is still going on.
Yeah. In case of a bounce check, the receipt of a notice, is it necessary? So, say I get a notice and I by some means I don't receive the notice. So,
when we go back as unclaimed. Unclaimed is good service. It means that you know the contents of it and you've chosen not to take it. So, I would always advise people, whatever notice is come, you should always accept it, because the minute it goes unclaimed, there's an implied meaning to it that you know the contents of.
But then the record is that there's nobody at home.
Nobody at home.
Is
you chose, what is the point of the person sending you the notice with nobody at home? The very fact that you reside there, you have chosen not to be accepted.
And what is the how has to be said within 3 days from the
amount has to be paid?
For instance, they paid on the 18th day. Can the other person still have to?
Technically, yes, he can.
Because there are
certain
cases not to still be there.
The law of action is available.
Yeah.
But there are certain judgments which, once the process is also issued, if you paid on the first day, then the matters can be performed. So that would come to the help of.
Lastly, should a bounce check be supported by any agreement or a document or a bounce check?
No, there is a presumption, that's what I said. There is a presumption that the person owes you money. There is a legally enforceable liability. Until unless that person rebuts that presumption, it is in favor of the person who the complaint is.
For example, donation check getting returned, sir.
Cash is raised.
Not exactly. Until unless there's an 18GS and 18GS green.
Can we issue more than one notice? And what about the limitation?
See, earlier there was a judgment which said that only if the check bounces, then if you issue a notice, then you cannot issue the second notice, which is still the case. But if the check bounces, you issue a notice,
yes,
and for some reason you need to deposit the check,
right,
you can send the notice again based on the second deposit.
Okay. Then what about the limitation period?
It will start from the day you send the second
notice.
But if for the same deposit you send two notices,
right,
then your limitation starts from your first notice, not from the second.
Is the summons to the accused accompanied by the copy of the complaint?
Yeah,
so he is entitled to
yes, the copy of the complaint. Normally, someone also reads that complaint.
If the summons is not accompanied with the complaint, then what happens?
You can always ask for it once you reach the court. You can show it to the court that I have not gotten it. So
that means you have to appear before the court. You have to personally appear before the court.
Or through a lawyer.
Okay.
The summons would always read, appear in person or through the leader. So we read the summons, not daring one today, but...
What is the law today for the issuer of the check if he instructs that please don't deposit the check?
Stop payment.
What is the law today?
No, you can still be prosecuted.
Yeah.
So the very fact you issue a check, that means that you issued it for some liability.
Earlier there was some Supreme Court decision which said that if you...
That's also a question of trial, whether when you make a stop payment, why you made the stop payment, because either you declared the liability and all. So those are all question of prior. So you could be exonerated after the full fledged fine.
Sir, you are right, because earlier that Supreme Court judgment was there, where stop payment was not covered under 138 proceedings. But now that Supreme Court has said it, because of all question of, otherwise every person issuing cheque would immediately enter the stop payment proceedings. I would say that now I am not bound by 138
proceedings. My question is to Mr. Yogesh, any bank is put without cheque issue. Waiting after waiting for the person who gave the check to give the date. He doesn't give the date, then recipient put the date and deposit the check. So in those cases, can the action be taken?
Yes. The very fact you give a person a check without a date, you are authorizing him to fill the date. The section 20 of the negotiable instrument act will come to your rescue at that time. Giving an incomplete authorize the person, then you are entitled to sue.
Yes, second question. Sometimes check is given and the person who gives a check at the time of hearing, he claimed that check was given as a security. He should not have deposited the check. What happened in those?
Again, that is question of trial, whether he can prove it that it was given as security. That's all a question of trial. Without a trial, you can't get out just because it was given as security.
So, during your talk, you had mentioned the Chartered Accountant audit report is the basis of his being called up in future because he collides with the bankers. Now, as a chartered accountant, when any chartered accountant gives an audit report,
yes,
we give it to the best of our knowledge and belief. There is a very famous quote in his saying, during my college days and my CA days, I learned that a chartered accountant is a watchdog and not a bloodhound. So, whenever we do an audit, we do it in the best interest of our client and we give an audit report taking the facts of the case.
Yes.
So, under what circumstances that audit report will bring him in trouble in future. How can we prove that he has collided with the bankers?
Now
that is my query.
Yes, I understand.
Because would you say that every chartered accountant, every report has, because I believe that criminal proceedings, there is no time limit. So since I became a chartered accountant, all audit reports, I am
liable. Reasonableness of initiating the proceeding would still come into play. I understand that the issue is that not that every chartered accountant will be called up. As I said, during inquiry, they would be questioned about the audit report. Now, if you are able to establish that this audit report was made by me, by looking at this document which are provided to me by the director of the company or this my client, if they are not questionable documents, then yes, you can be exonerated and inquiry stage and you can become a witness. Because you will become a star witness in that situation, that even you were one of the victims where he misguided you to issue such kind of audit report. But there is one more added to that, but the moment if you come to know that your audit report is based on some bogus document or bogus information which is given to you, then it is your duty to make a complaint against your client. That was the rehabilitation here.
Just
a
couple of questions that have come. Well, someone has sent this question that can complain under 138 business if borrower has not passed resolution under section of the company right. Now, normally what we do is we give a certified copy of the extract of the resolution, which is a secondary evidence. It's not the original. So until unless you produce the minute book and you put on record the copy of the original minute, the complaint can't give. Because your resolution, your power is not exhibited till you don't produce your original. It's your company.
where the company is filing, someone has to come forward. Yeah, you can still prosecute them. There's no once if the
but magistrate says they were not enforceable. It is not legally enforceable.
No, not all. It all depends on your transaction.
Transaction is true, but because there is one complaint in the company there, he says negotiable.
Then whether the debt is legally enforceable or not. The minute it's established that it's legally enforceable, you can if it dismiss, you can challenge that.
You have to have.
Yes, you are. That option is always open.
Yogesh, can you throw light on the requirement of money lending license?
Now, money lending license, this is what a lot of matters have got dismissed. So there are certain judgments that you have a loan without on interest, without holding a money lending license. Now, this is also a niche field where people are nowadays, a lot of people sometime back, they should give money to people on interest because you can get 24% interest, whereas banks want you much lesser. Well, to some extent, you require a money lending license. But again, in the money lending, the Maharashtra Money Lending Act, which is now come in force, and earlier it was the Bombay Money Lending Act, the definition of a loan is prescribed. So, minute the loan is given for, and there's a bill of exchange there, then you are out of the money lending. But if it's a promising note and the loan is above 3,000, then you come under the ambit of money lending. NBFC doesn't require this. This is for individuals who are giving loans. But NBFC,
you have a sense of business.
It's prescribed in the
RBI.
RBI.
Straight talk, and I would request all of you to just sit for 5 minutes.
minutes so that we can properly offer our vote of appreciation. Just be there for 5 minutes, you will not take more. I request Narayan to do the.
Thank you, President. First of all, the announcements. Next Wednesday, 17 December, BCS organized a lecture meeting under the Dilip Dalal Oration Fund at KC Law College Auditorium. The speaker is Swami Swatmanandaji, Chinmaya Mission, Mumbai, and the topic is Pursuing Excellence in Profession, a Holistic Approach. Jhankar Together and Networking Carnival, we have displayed a board here, which is organized by the HR committee, spearheaded by the youth wing of BCA, is this weekend, 13th and 14th December, at Jashoda Rang Mandir, next to NM College. Various events will be conducted at this carnival. Request all members to participate in large numbers. This being a lecture by advocates, I still feel there are some people in the audience who are not members of the BCA. In short, BCA is a voluntary organization which principle-centered and learning organization promoting quality service and excellence in the profession of chartered accountants. There are more than 9,000 members from all across the country. Some benefits of BCA membership is monthly BCA journal. You can also become a journal member. Various publications are published by BCA on a number of topics. Annual referencer, which is a must for any CA, web TV, and lot many. You can visit our website. Friends, we regularly read, especially in newspaper, words like IPC, CPC, NC, FIR, anticipatory bail, arrest, white collar crime, trial, jurisdiction, cognizable offense, accused, summons, prosecutor, etc., etc. But we did not know and understand their meanings in detail. Today, both our learner speakers, Advocate Niranjan Mundargi and Advocate Yogesh Israni, explained to us in a very layman's language the basic concepts of the Indian Penal Code, the Criminal Penal Code, and the check bouncing law. Questions asked by you were also answered by them to your satisfaction. It is said, court kachari se bachna bhai log, but today I feel we have been more enlightened through their talk, and they have set the law in motion. I, on behalf of BCS, propose a hearty vote of thanks to these learner speakers and request all of you to carry it with a loud applause.